Hello, everyone. Thanks for coming on this beautiful night, beautiful spring night, even though it's early March. I'm Luis Jaramillo, the director of the Creative Writing Program. Thanks so much for coming here. We're happy to have back to the New School our friends from Cave Canem for a Poets on Craft evening. These are really great events, and we're a school, so it's really great to actually really dig into the poetry after we hear people read. I'd like to thank a few people first, Randy Brown Jr., Julie Goldberg, Lori Lynn Turner, and we have a full evening, so without further ado, I'd like to welcome to the podium Nicole Seeley, Programs Director for Cave Canem and the author of Animal After Whom Other Animals Are Named, a chapbook that's coming out in April. Please welcome up Nicole Seeley.
Hi, everyone. Good evening. Again, my name is Nicole Seeley, and I'm the Programs Director at Cave Canem Foundation, a national organization dedicated to cultivating the artistic and professional growth of Black poets. We have exciting upcoming programs, including a lecture on Duende by poet John Murillo at Cave Canem next Tuesday, 6:30. And the Cave Canem Book Prize deadline is also next Tuesday, 11:59 p.m. The prize is open to Black poets who have not yet published a full-length collection of poetry. For more information about this and other programs, please visit cavecanempoets.org. I'd like to thank the New School's MFA Creative Writing Program, especially Luis Jaramillo and Lori Lynn Turner. We're in our second decade collaborating with the New School, and we couldn't have asked for a more generous partner, and it's always so great to work with friends, so thank you. Thanks also to the Whiting Foundation, the New York State Council on the Arts, and the New York City Department of Cultural Affairs, and of course, all of you. It is my pleasure to introduce Monica Ferrell and Kyle Dargan. Monica Ferrell is the author of the novel The Answer Is Always Yes, one of Booklist's top 10 debut novels of 2008. Her collection of poems, Beasts for the Chase, was a 2009 finalist for the Asian American Writers Workshop Prize. Her work has appeared in a public space, The New Republic, The Believer, The New York Review of Books, among other journals. She is the recipient of a Wallace Stegner Fellowship at Stanford University, a Discovery the Nation Prize, and a fellowship from the Civitella Ranieri Foundation. Kyle Dargan is the author of four collections of poetry, most recently Honest Injun. For his work, he has received the Cave Canem Poetry Prize, the Hurston Wright Legacy Award, and grants from the DC Commission on the Arts and Humanities. Dargan has partnered with the President's Committee on the Arts and Humanities to produce poetry programming at the White House and Library of Congress. He is currently an Associate Professor of Literature and Director of Creative Writing at American University. Monica and Kyle will each read their work. Following their readings, Cave Canem Fellow Kyla Marshell, whose nonfiction has appeared in Gawker, The Guardian, O, the Oprah Magazine, and others, will moderate a conversation between them. Following the reading, you'll have the opportunity to buy books and sign up to be on Cave Canem's mailing list. Please welcome Monica Ferrell, who will be followed by Kyle Dargan. Thank you.
Hi, everyone, and thank you so much to Nicole Seeley for organizing this, and to Kyla Marshell, who is going to conduct the conversation. I'm so honored to be here tonight as a guest on behalf of Cave Canem, and thank you so much for coming out on, as Luis said, this gorgeous evening. I know it's kind of the outdoors are competing for your attention, so thank you. I'm going to read a few poems from a book that is going to come out in 2 years' time with Four Way. It just got taken, and it's called Oh, You Absolute Darling. So I'll start with that, and then I'll read a couple poems from the book that's here. This first one is called The Date, and I don't think it needs an introduction. The Date. This time will come gloved and blindfolded, we'll arrive on time, with bees in our hair, with an escort of expiring swans. We'll appear to out of date and out of tune, violin music, we'll lie on our side, wearing rotting lotus behind our ears, musk between our thighs. This time we'll be tied down, we'll cry out. We'll only smoke if surprised by tragedy's approach as it noses closer. This time we'll fall in love with the blood color of the sunset as we're walking home, over the bridge that takes us between here and there. This time we'll forget how ancient Sarmatian lions go on, bearing marble messages for no one who can understand their sarcophagus language. Forget sloths who climb so slow they die before mating. We'll grow improvident and stop believing there was ever such a thing as alone. Such a hard nail in the coffin for one. This is actually true about sloths, that apparently they come down from their trees once a year to mate, and they're really very slow, if you know anything about a sloth, and they lumber along looking for a partner. And if they don't find one on that day, they have to go back up in the tree and wait another year to mate. So I guess be glad you're not a sloth. This is called anatomy. Man shaped out of mud and made to speak in love. Let's stick in him a little whisperer, a bucket with two holes. Let's give him the great deceiver, a bloodstone. A church with a vaulted ceiling where the white and blue Niles meet. A dog who cries after dark. Everyone has a heart, even the people who don't. It floats up like a beached whale in the autopsy. The heart has no sense of humor. It offers itself piteously like a pair of handcuffs and is so clumsy we turn away. The past is a quarry full of marble statues with hands and genitals erased. But the heart is a muscle made of shark bone and mutters, resting place softened with hay, where all the cows come home, finally. If you know You're All About Eve, there's a distorted quotation from in there. I think in All About Eve it says, everyone has a heart except some people. So let's even give the people who don't a heart. This is called Savage Bride. You need me like ice needs the mountain on which it breeds, like print needs the page. You move in me like the tongue in a mouth, like wind in the leaves of summer trees, gust fists, hollow except of movement and desire, which is movement. You taste me the way the claws of a pigeon taste that window ledge on which it sits, the way water tastes rust in the pipes it shuttles through beneath a city, unfolding and luminous with industry. Before you were born, the table of elements was lacking, and I, as a noble gas, floated free of attachment. Before you were born, the sun and the moon were paper-thin plates. Some machinist at his desk merely clicked into place. I always thought it was so sad when I learned about the table of elements, that there are these things called noble gases that nobody wants to bond with. So somehow that stuck in me from high school. And why are they called noble? It should be called depressed gases. Glacier. Every 16-year-old girl likes a murderer for an admirer. His hands on her, his eyes on her from the hotel's third floor balcony as she lugs her skis from the slope. His gaze slits wool and cotton as she walks, safety razor sharp along the thigh. His words have stubbed in her, radiant suns. Wonders what it would be like, whether her parents would find her first, in morgue light, the eyelids turned astonishingly exact, final, attendants circulating about the table on rubber soles that squeak. One gets cut in that kind of blizzard, fiberglass in the lungs. The man in question, never apprehended, is sensitive and likes her hair pulled back. She stays away, though not too far to see, blue eyes open toward her through the mercury air. Cornflower blue, blue of lasers, malevolent as the circles of gas on a stove, as the blue kiss on the matchstick that drags a house down. One time she walked into the glacier's fog storm, its Catherine wheel of swirling white, and moan, as all the while crevasses yawned beneath her feet invisibly. No one would ever find her, hanging like crystals in a cave forever. It's as though she wants to spell a sentence in the book of infinity, to be the one child who doesn't come home when her mother's setting place at dusk. Never read that one out loud before. It's brand new. So on a lighter note, and feel free to laugh at this one, I had this boyfriend once, and he said to me many curious and offensive things, and I remembered them. And I decided to make a poem out of all of these things, so I just rearranged them into a text. I only changed one word, so this is all verbatim otherwise. And it's the title poem, "Oh, You Absolute Darling." You are sexier than anyone I've ever met. You feel better to touch than anyone I've ever met. You're like a Vargas girl. You're not exactly a barrel of laughs, so much as a barrel of erections. Dear gypsy-themed Barbie doll, those jeans will do you no good. If I were a mosquito, I'd suck all the blood out from you in 5 minutes. If we were stranded together on a desert island, I don't think you'd last long. I'd like to come over there and squeeze the living daylights out of you. I'd like to spin you like a top and fuck you 10 different ways. Such tender meat, raw, dropping from the bone. You're sex on a stick. You're a sex bomb. You're the sex symbol of our set. And this is why you have the male friends you think you do, why women hate you. The last 12 years, you have no idea how many millions of haploid gametes I've spilled in your honor. How I've resented you for walking around as though you were a normal person. I'm sorry to break it to you. Let me explain how this works. When X said he threw away your press photo, what he meant was, it's tacked up in his bathroom right now for inspiration. I think you think my attraction to you is funny. Believe me, scared is how you should be. You're a basket of sexual fruits. What kind of fruit are you? I'd like to eat you up with my penis, but I don't know how to do that. You smell like peach. You smell like mango. The way you smell drives me crazy. The divots in your back drive me wild. I love the scoop above your ass, your slender throat, your little pretty limbs and princess face, your gorgeous rippling muscles covered all over by this smooth, this tawny upholstery. Little doll, delicate flower, the way your ribs stick out, it's like a second rack. And this, I love this. What do people call it? You should always be naked. You should always hold your wine glass like so. You have what no one else has, breasts that demand to be taken notice of, and the tiniest waist I've ever seen. If your waist were any smaller, you wouldn't exist. Which was, if your waist were any smaller, it wouldn't exist. But I got the picture that it was, the self was dissolving underneath all of that praise. So today is International Women's Day, and I was thinking about that. I have this poem that imagines what the women in the harem might sound like if they talked about their confinement. So this is called Harem Song. Blue crocuses cincture the snake's hole. Monkeys in the palms gibber wild. By midnight, we'll be drunk or high when he arrives with the smile of a man who's just gotten away with murder. White peacocks shake their tails and strut. Say, Effendi. Say, pearl of the pure of heart, if he chooses you. Or just open your mouth as though in surprise. White peacocks panic in the tall ferns, the reeds. If he can't get it up, he'll fall asleep in your lap as though it were history. Listen, that's the oud player tuning up. I don't want to tell you how to do this, but you might think about a little coal, a few jewels. You might take a look at whatever's happening with your bust. The oud player coughs when our Lord can't get it up. Ivy in the pool comes apart. Somewhere a mutiny is tearing loose from its tree like ripe fruit. But as for now, little border, orphan, we're here in this pavilion, briefly, this galley deep and porthole place called Earth, and you must row your bit, sister. See how lovely you are in the mirror. You must consider, it was the will, your beauty. It was the shiny machine, made a garden of Eden in your veins and paradise of your soft sigh. I'll check the time. I think I'm just gonna read one poem from the book and then from the book that's here and then two more poems from the new collection. So I was looking at these German paintings for a while, and I noticed that there was this theme that kept coming up called Geburt des Marienkinds, which means birth of the Mary child, and their portrayals of, we're so used to seeing Madonna and child, but what it was like when the Virgin Mary was born. And so I started imagining my own birth and what that could have been like. I mean, I was there, but I don't exactly remember. And I was born in New Delhi, so there's a line here about getting a smallpox shot, which I guess we don't really do here anymore, but it was definitely done there. Geburt des Monikakins. I woke. A tiny knot of skin on a silver table, set in the birth theater, blinking in the glare of electric lights and a strange, arranged passel of faces, huge as gods in their council. I was the actor who forgets his lines and enters on stage, suddenly wanting to say, I am. I was almost all I. They weighed me down. Two lump big brown sugar bags in a face which did not yet know struggle, burden. How the look of newborns unnerves. Then they wrapped me in pale yellow like a new sun, still too small to throw up into the sky. It was midnight when they injected me with a plague. Tamed, faded as imperialism, pox had once put its palm leaf hand over a quarter of Earth, saying, these. Now it was contracted to a drop. And in the morning, I knew both death and life. Lapped in my nimbus of old gold light, my huge lashes drooped over my deepened eyes, like ostrich feather shades over twin crown princes, their wet heads sleek and doomed as the black soul of an open poppy. I'll read a poem called Poetry, which is as close as I get to an Ars Poetica, which you may know is really just a fancy way of saying a poem about the art of poetry. And poets often do this to sort of reflect on what writing means to them. Though I wrote the whole thing without realizing that's what it was until later, poetry. There is nothing beautiful here, however I may want it. I can't spin a crystal palace of this thin air, weave a darkness plush as mole fur with my tongue, however I want. Yet I am not alone in these alleys of vowels, which comfort me as the single living nun of a convent is comforted by the walls of that catacomb she walks at night, lit by her own moving candle. I am not afraid of mirrors or the future, or even you, lovers, wandering cow fat and rutting in the gardens of this earthly verge, where I too trod, a sunspot, parasol shaded, kin to the trees, the bees, the color green. And I'll close out with a poem called Days of Oakland. I lived in Oakland for a while, and where I was, there were occasionally these, my apartment would be invaded by the lights of these helicopters that were circling and circling. I didn't know what they were doing, but I kind of imagined an explanation. And having moved back, I kind of missed that old apartment, so I was thinking, what was it like when I lived in Oakland? Now and then you heard the copters flying in search of inmates who'd escaped. Mostly, though, it was quiet. At night, outside, the cats would fight and fuck and knock shit down. The couple next door would simmer in heat or bitterness. Sometimes you saw them in the window glass, appearing like quarter moons through mist. There was a drip, of course, drip, 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 endless in the bathtub's white expanse as Napoleon's soldiers entering Russia. A whiteness like that is staggering. A woman alone is a cave of violets, a man alone a squirming rat who squeaks. At night, the cats would fight and fuck. At night, inmates ran into fields of liberty and so were saved. While obsessively, out of destitute hope, copters' dilated eyes went on roving. It was like trying to push a mountain up a river or drag a body behind you with one hand. A woman alone is fire on a mountain, light in darkness, night flowers opening unobserved, releasing their scent into everywhere. A woman alone is a shuttered garden, heaped on the edge of a cliff. The identity of the bridegroom is slowly revealed. There is no turning back from that face. Thank you.
Thank you, Cave Canem, for organizing this event. Thank you to the New School for opening your space to us. And thank you, Monica, for that lovely reading. So I hope this doesn't mess you up, Kyla. I'm going to read a little bit from the book, maybe two poems, but mostly read from two other new manuscripts, one new book and something else I'm working on, and a new one is selected. So my birthday in November, was getting up to go to the gym. Want to work out on your birthday, keep it tight. Get as many birthdays as you can out of this life. And I showed up at the gym and there are news cameras everywhere. I'm thinking I'm not that important. And go inside and I find out that one of the trainers, this guy I played basketball with, had started dating one of the members, and I guess they had some disagreement the night before, and he shot her in her house. Then a couple, I guess, weeks after that, I found out that a good friend of mine had knowingly been given an STD by someone she started dating. And then last week, I'm not on Facebook, but people started DMing me about Thomas. And, I reached out to Amanda Johnson to find out what was going on, and she's telling me all this, and I realized that I knew some of these women, at least I'd known they had gone through these things, but I didn't know that the person was Thomas, who is a friend of mine. So I was just sitting in my office just sort of thinking about all of this, and I was like, just sitting there, it's dealing with men socially, romantically, it's like a fucking minefield. For some people, you don't know. And, you know, I thought about that for a minute, and I was like, I wondered, like, how true that is. I was like, to work that metaphor. So I went and found some texts on what it's like or what one should do in terms of navigating a minefield. So like your poem, Monica, I took some stuff out. I rearranged some stuff. And I replaced the word mine. I mean, changed other language, too. But the main thing is I replaced the word mine with men just to see what would happen. So I'm going to start there, and I have some other poems, I guess, on this theme. But this is the first piece, Minefields. Remember that men don't behave as they do in the movies. You won't hear a click or generally have a warning before the man is activated. Many men may be encased in cloth, plastic, or their mere tufted hide, so a metal detector won't necessarily warn you. Be mindful of withholding speech when you are in a manned area. The frequencies of your silence may cause certain types of men to detonate. If other men are present, the detonation of one man may set off a chain reaction. Areas experiencing armed conflict are clearly high risk, but men remain dangerous long after the cessation of hostilities. Though you can't count on manned areas being marked, heed warning signs, often but not always red, and they rarely say men or danger. Where the signs aren't present, improvised warnings are often used, such as blood-crusted smiles, indicating a crossed boundary, unexamined kits, torn blouses quilted into flags, hair tied to trees. Never assume a recently cleared area is safe. Men removal is a difficult and risky process. It's not unusual for men to remain in areas that have officially been cleared. One reason for this is that men that are buried in ground for a long time may sink substantially. Men can't be buried in roads paved for dialogue. Keep in mind, however, that men may be wedged in potholes or trip wires tied to men on the periphery that may be drawn across these roads. Should you suspect that you have entered a manned area, either because you see warning signs, you see a man or potential man, or because a detonation occurs, keep your wits and carefully retreat from danger by backing into your own footsteps. If you can't see your footprints to backtrack, move forward little by little. You'll need to probe the ground for men. Probe the ground very carefully. Use your hands or feet. Use your pen or knife. Probe at an angle rather than straight down, since men are easily detonated from top-down pressure. Be wary of picking up anything. Many men are booby traps. You think you're picking up a song, a shield, or a heart, then, lo and behold, there's a man inside. Even God vows and children are used as bait. Rule number one of keeping your thumbs: if you didn't drop it, don't pick it up. If you find yourself the leader in a situation, you'll need to coach every member of your troop on how to exit a manned area safely. Make sure you're talking, that you're all on the same page, because one wrong move could get everyone killed. The Venus of Slapboxing. My sister announced her disapproval with a certain contrapposto, her neck cricked to the side, chin tucked as if to say, "Oh, really?" Then followed the soft sculpting of her frame. From first rib through right leg, she cured like a brick arch, her arms raised into brimming V's set for mantis snaps. Suddenly, your name was punk or heifer, never a good thing. I danced around all her invitations to spar. Not once did I witness her storied bouts. I wondered if she even needed to fight. Did her mere stance forecast a cyclone of knuckles none dead wished to dance within? It did that, the city, turned girls into forces of nature, furious, short-lived. Today I watch a man slap box with a woman at the U8 bus stop, and my feet understand the measured distance he keeps between himself and her form. It's the same space I held between myself and my sister, the distance any wise fool knows to maintain between himself and a decided woman, between his chin and her yet thrown blows. Now we go to the book. I don't ever read this poem because, I don't know, I'm always afraid my mother's going to be in the audience. But I'm gonna read it because, I don't know, just one of those things. Art project. God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful, increase in number, fill the earth and subdue it. Genesis 1:28. I walked among men with the task of pausing, let me start over. I walked among men for a year with the task of pausing if I heard one speak the words, I fucked her. At that point, I produced for them a sketch pad and kindly request drawings of what each man implied. Those too shy only stared at uninked pages. No shame, I assured. God knows what you Google, those O's his eyes, and still you have not been struck down, so draw. Some began tracing from memory the curves and buds of breasts. No, no, give me symbols, give me act, I implored. They drew boulders crushing other boulders into sand, or guns fired point blank through panes of ice. One drew a pickup truck, its revving tires stripping pelts from the road. The trend was one of leaving something marred, if not wholly shattered. I was not bold enough to ask those men turned artists if they desire what they drew, to be themselves fucked. Rather, I inquired why they thought the women wanted what their art promised. One said, it's not women, it's their bodies. The earth breaks, desires to be broken. Another, the girls, I mean, they beg for it. Harder, harder, they say, fuck me. Deaf to the ways language acts as landscape. What if the women are only speaking back to the easels they see behind male eyes? Imagine if God had appeared before man as a self-portrait of a woman. Would they have listened when he did not sketch the earth as a body men needed to subdue? Where am I now? Sorry, it's going to be a tough reading. I'm just letting you know right now. There's no funny stuff in this reading. Maybe you get funny during the Q&A, but the stuff I have to do. Another me. My transcript attests to it, so let it be true. Third year, I registered for Psych 101, having failed to distinguish psychology from psychiatry. Nevertheless, there were requirements to be fulfilled. Shakespeare and Chaucer had been granted enough of my brain to annex. Wouldn't psychology teach me how one redeems his mind's territories? There was, too, an incentive. The friend who suggested we both enroll, the friend I called a sister to stem any looming attraction. It's practically a rite of passage, the course one takes because the eyes, as much as the brain, need to be fed. And how I discredited my eyes after their tracing of her skin led me into a semester worth of notes on dopamine and endorphins and GABA. All alien-looking neurons, no psychoanalysis. The midterms jargon glut frenzied us into library sessions and study dates at my upper-class dorm. We drilled neurotransmitters, labeled cell parts until our eyelids failed under the weight of dendrites and synapses. She asked one night if she could crash on her couch, what play siblings do. But when she woke, she thanked me for not touching her while she purred, prone there. Definition: mental confusion, a state characterized by a lack of clear and orderly thought. That me suddenly did not know who he was. Could he be brother to someone who could suspect him, a rapist? Definition: anticipation, the imagining of a future event which elicits an emotional response. That night, that me convinced himself that his character was the victim, grown that men might as well act as their typecast. That me disavowed that sister who was not a sister but a young woman he found comely. When another me, years later, revisits that night, he knows how little it takes for women's bodies to become bounty in men's minds. Cognitive dissonance makes it possible to rationalize rape, another concept we would not learn that semester. What I did learn: trust can mute stress so one may slumber. What I did learn: for prey, experience is a spectrum that blurs the safe wavelengths of light. What I learned: when men yowl, there's no understanding women. Many of us mean we sat for the test without studying and then resent the possibility of being wrong. Another poem that doesn't get read when my mother's present. And I'll probably just read two, three more, get to the conversation. So the title of this poem is not a, it reads like a statement, but it's not a statement. It's more of a question, something to think about after you get to the end. There's no power in sex. I can't say it is the reason he called me, but I'll remember it as the conversation in which my friend divulged that a mutual acquaintance gives amazing head. He may have even said brains or dome, his lingo rising further and further away from the act. My friends enlist me in these wars of knowledge, priming my imagination to conjure women I only know casually with mouthfuls of phallus. Personally, I don't enjoy head. That I cannot say around other men. I feel more comfortable walking towards the Pentagon shouting, Inshallah. It's treasonous for a man to admit he doesn't relish fellatio. In my nightmares, other men smash into my bedroom door, drag me from sleep, accuse, you started this. The day the world's women deny them their fantasies privilege. I seek no revolution, too messy. The truth is, there's no easier way to find a woman who will offer you head than to confess that you don't like it. Well, you haven't had me do it. The matter is not one of personal technique. Women don't believe me when I say that as a boy, there was no retort that cut deeper than to bark back at another boy, suck my dick, maybe a bitch at it for punctuation. I can't separate that history from the act. Can't think of head as casual, as a gesture other than subjugation. Some women claim they feel powerful taming the lower serpent. I think, in the mind's recesses, that their men mouth, suck my dick, bitch, getting off on the penitent posture, the bobbing bow. I cannot judge. I simply want no part of the battle between affection and dominance. But even that is not true. I love to enlist my tongue in the name of racking, to pin down the pelvis and fiddle over the clitoris as though with each graze of my tongue, it becomes a new bead on an endless rosary of release. This isn't fair. You won't let me do that for you. I'm accused of stubbornness, fear of my own vulnerability. I say, it's my body. I have the right to refuse any touch, just as much as you have the right to tell me to stop. Do you want me to stop? To retreat? I ask disingenuously. I ask without removing my lips. Sorry, I keep starting this back up. All right, one poem to finish. Oh, it's a good poem to finish on. It's a good place to end. Good. All right. The erotic is a measure between, after Lord. Your body is not my pommel horse, nor my Olympic pool or diving board. Your body is not my personal internet channel, nor my timeline, nor my warm Apollo spotlight. Your body is not my award gala. Your body is not my game, preseason, or playoffs. Your body is not my political party convention. Your body is not my front line or my wars theater. Your body is not my time trial. Your body is not my entrance exam or naturalization interview. I am a citizen of this skin alone, and yours is not to be passed or won. What is done when we let our bodies sharpen the graphite of each other's bodies, it is not my test, not my solo show. One day, I'll learn. I'll prove I know how to lay with you without anticipating the scorecards of your eyes. How I might merely abide, we two, unseated, equidistant from the wings, in a beating black box, all stage. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. Well, that was kind of intense. You know, it's a good thing, Kyle, that your mother wasn't here, I would say, for some of those poems.
It's sad that you're right.
What?
It's sad that you're right, but you're right.
Yeah, well, what your poems make me think of, and Monica, also your poem about, can everyone hear me? Okay, your poem about, how about that? That better? Okay. Your poem about the ex-boyfriend and his love for your shrinking, essentially. You both touched on themes of loneliness and attachment and some of the more disturbing elements of interpersonal relationships. But you're coming from pretty different perspectives. Kyla's male and Monica's female. Could you each talk about what has inspired you to venture into those topics? Especially, I think that poem is sort of distinct from the other work of yours that I've read. So what about it resonated for you? And Kyle, you can also talk about what draws you to those themes in your work.
Oh, gosh. I'm a feminist. and I think that one, the person in question was so in love with his own voice and his own vocabulary. Mm-hmm. Like haploid gametes was a direct quote. So anyone who chooses to use that kind of vocabulary to talk about that, you know. And I think that language was being used as a kind of like domination almost, you know, and I really didn't have anything to say back. There was a mansplaining. I didn't have that term then, but that was going on about desire. And so I wanted to subvert that. I mean, I really wanted to see if there was a way of turning it on its head using the words of that same person. And I've tried to do, I've really loved your first poem with the changing out the minds for man. I thought it worked so beautifully. I have tried to do like there was this, in the summer of 2011, there were a few incidents of just like terrible violence against women. That was the summer that that guy went into a gym, into like an aerobics class and shot up, like just killed a bunch of women for no reason. And I pored over his diaries that were published on the internet, and I tried to see if I could rearrange that into a poem. And I also used, it was the same summer that a bunch of people were again talking about, I don't know how you guys feel about Roman Polanski, but I think he's a rapist. he is one. So, and people were again mounting this, you know, public debate about, oh, let's bring him back and pardon him and let's have him come to America. And so I tried to rearrange the text of that as well into a poem. So, I'm interested in subverting the discourse by, you know, with the tools of the vocabulary that we've been given.
I think for me, my life is very different, at least my social structure is very different now than it was when I was a teenager. I went to, you know, all-boys school for 6 years. So most of my friends were my, you know, classmates. And, you know, now I really don't hang out with many men at all. And it's really interesting how different the conversations are. Because often, you know, when you're around a bunch of men, and even in the rare occasion that a bunch of men get together and actually talk about masculinity, like, which is rare. That's one thing that I always go to school and I say, how often do you talk about what it's like to be a man with like other children, other boys your age? And it's like, yeah, we don't talk about that, which is sort of, you know, the big issue. So thinking about that, I just had to like stop and start combing through my mind and say, well, how much of the stuff that, you know, that I believe about my masculinity, are those things I actually believe, or those things that I have been, you know, that I've inherited, that I picked up along the way, and just it's like I have this assumed masculinity versus constructed masculinity. And then going back through it, I was like, holy crap, like I don't believe most of this stuff. Mm-hmm. And so that's when I started working on this new project, Panzerhurst, which is the manuscript where I'm deconstructing my own masculinity. And it's important that I sort of make that distinction, that it's my masculinity. Like, it's so broad. Like, I don't think anyone could sort of deconstruct masculinity. Like, this is just me looking at, you know, how I've moved through the world with this gender role and this body. I there are people doing this, you know. Ross is doing it. Dinez is doing it. Douglas Brown is doing it. You know, Tony Hoagland is doing it, and so although there are other issues with Tony Hoagland. But I just think there sort of needs to be a grounds, because like the thing is other people have been doing this work for men for so long. It's like that time, like men need to start doing this work for themselves and not like putting it off on, you know, women. So that's part of where it comes from. And, you know, just being comfortable being wrong, because you know they're going to be like, you're not going to get it right every time. But just hoping that you do it well enough so people can understand like why you're trying to do it. I think that's enough.
Mm-hmm. Well, in a lot of your work, particularly in this last book, there's a real openness and an exposure to the kinds of things you're talking about. You've really laid a lot out on the table about your own fears, insecurities, and whatnot. For me, reading it, I was thinking, wow, this is really so open, you know, and brave, I would say also. What do you think is the value of willing to be so open about some of your private fears or your private life, as opposed to being obscure?
I guess for me, that's one of the ultimate challenges of poetry, is being your whole self on the page, right? Because most of the time, people writing poems, it's the curated self that's on the page. And, you know, that's one of the things that I, you know, I'm always pointing out with my students. I'm like, what's wrong with this poem is that you're afraid to be here. You know, you want to put down something that, you know, sounds good and will, you know, convince someone else that, you know, this is a persona, but like this, that's not you on the page. And it's, I think the other, element of the book, since you read it, there's lots of death in there. My grandmother, my aunt, my college roommate, my other close friend. And so when you go through all that and you have all these people that are very close to you that aren't here anymore, and you kind of look around, it's like, well, like, what am I hiding from? Like, what am I, holding? What's the point? I might not be here tomorrow. So you want to leave with as much comfortably of yourself. The main thing is, and I think this is the tricky part, just make sure as you're doing that, you're not exploiting other people. So I think that's, for me, that's actually harder than putting myself, like, I can put myself on the page, no problem. But I don't ever want to do it in a way where I'm utilizing someone else's story and experience in a way that they haven't necessarily authorized. So I think for me, that was harder than putting myself on the page to make sure I'm not putting anyone else's business out there. If they want to put that out there, that's on them. That's not my call.
Monica, in your work, one thing I was thinking, especially in conversation with Kyle's work, is that there's a real richness to your poems, but I'm not seeing, like, this poem's about Monica. Mm-hmm. And so reading these two books in conversation, I was thinking, wow, this is a poem about things going on very detailed in Kyle's life. In your poems, the self is, the individual is perhaps more obscured. So I was wondering, in terms of some of the things you're writing about the German paintings, and there's a lot of mythology, there's a lot of fairy tales, and it gets in there, these very haunting poems, I would say. Is there a self, is there a Monica in there that is coming through in some other form, or is it just another way you're expressing your interests?
Yeah, it's something that I've sort of pushed against. Okay, how'd you do that? There we go, okay. It's something that I pushed against with this new work, where I was accused by a friend in grad school of having what he called a cult of history, because there were a lot of historical people and mythological things, and he felt like I was, hiding behind that. And I didn't agree with him, but I did sort of take that on as a challenge that, like, next time I would do something different. So I think the new stuff, gets the, more, it's a little bit more overt. And part of that is I set myself the challenge of, like, using curse words, actually, because, I use them in real life, and it felt so wrong to put them in a poem. But then that signaled to me that I was kind of keeping this barrier between my normal consciousness and, like, that filtered self, or that prettified self that gets into a poem. So I have definitely tried to push against it. But with the first collection, what I felt wasn't fair about the criticism was that I felt like that stuff was me, in the sense that it was, like, the earliest me. It was the stuff that, as a kid, I loved to read. I loved to read myths, I loved to read fairy tales, and I was, like, a big history geek. So those books kind of furnished me with, like, the imagery that was in my inmost self. So to me, it was revelatory, even if it wasn't reflective of, like, my daily life. It was like seeing inside, the paintings that are actually in my head. I don't mean, the ones in the museum, but, like, these characters or these mythological figures were really how I was interpreting my experience as a child. And then, yeah.
Another thing about this book, and if you all don't have it, you should get it, Beast for the Chase. Another thing that struck me is that I just felt like there was this really, a really ominous tone throughout. I kept feeling like you were looking at me and trying to tell me something. There's a poem called As the Eyelid Protects the Eye. I remember when I
almost read that, I just cut that the last minute.
There's this really great line, everything in the world knows what you are too asleep to see. Yeah. And that made me think, it, like, kind of jumped out at me, like, is there something I'm supposed to be seeing? And then I kept seeing all these eyeballs on things, literally, like a third eye on some random painting. And so I was wondering, was that kind of an intentional, that thing, that that ominous tone, or kind of projecting this unnamed but a sense of some kind of premonition.
Yeah, I can see that. I think it's still there. I mean, like, this current collection ends with the line, you know, the identity of the bridegroom is slowly revealed. There is no turning back from that face. And the book has a lot of, like, brides and bridegrooms and that thread throughout. But, you know, that's supposed to be, like, you'd think that if the identity of the bridegroom were revealed, that would be positive, but it's supposed to creep you out, you know, that, like, you are, you know, there's almost, like, looking at, like, a, you know, see, I was going to say, like, a Gorgon, this myth stuff is, like, so ingrained in me, but, yeah, it's, I think that, you know, Emily Dickinson has that line about, she knows she likes reading a poem when it takes the top of her head off, and I think I like reading poems, when you get, like, a chill at the, you know, back of your neck, when it just feels like, you know, everything is to the left of normal, or is, you know, it has some sort of other kind of charge, like the, you know, the world we experience in dreams a little bit, which, you know, everything is itself, but it also has some other meaning, often indecipherable. So but that's probably part of it.
So speaking of premonition, but in reverse, Kyle, your most recent book is reflecting a lot on the deaths in your life and some of the revelations you've come to recently. What's different now in your life as a person and as a writer that you couldn't have anticipated before this most recent phase in your life that inspired these poems?
I mean, again, I think it's just that willingness to let go of that need to be extra concerned about how you present, you know? Because, I mean, there's stuff in that book where, you know, and I think about this a lot, like, if I was really, 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 really deathly interested and invested in, like, trying to win certain things, like, there are poems that wouldn't be in that book. Like, the two poems that I read, they wouldn't have been in the book. But when I was putting it together, I said, you know what, that's a part of the arc of this journey that's in the book. Like, it would be wrong to excerpt that just to make the book more palatable. And I'm sure I have suffered for it, because I know there are some reviews that read those poems wrong, and, like, I haven't, like, stepped up and said, well, I mean, I feel like people have the right to interpret, you know, but they're straying very far from my intent. But I still but then there are all the other people, you know, who in private who or ever send me email, text, or whatever, and say, you know, like, that poem. I hate people call it this, but whatever. They're like, the head poem, like, that poem. And I'm like, well, you know, maybe that poem needed to be in the world. That's not something that you can know ahead of time. You just sort of have to, like, trust, you know, the writing that you're putting into it. So that's really what it was. It's kind of like trusting the arc of the whole book. Like, that book, more than any of my other books, it feels like a contiguous thing. Like, it's not, you know, some of the best poems I wrote up to this time, put in section and order, and it's kind of like, it's one sort of wave, that book, and certain things come out, and sort of the punch of it falls apart. And I felt more beholden to that than sort of, I guess, the industry viability of the book, though I still think it seems like it's still done okay.
What is it about those particular poems that would make the book not a prize book, or not an award-winning book?
So the local radio station in D.C., WMU, they interviewed for the book in the little, I guess, lead-up they do before the segment. You know, the radio host was like, in brutal language, Kyle Dark. I'm like, what the what is that? Like, it's not... Like, what? Because I the word bitch is in the poem, like, and like all the potty language in the book is pretty much like it's quotes, like, because I'm like you, I don't like, I'm not a big curse person, so you know, most of that language in there, I feel like I'm getting, like, I didn't even say that, like they said that, and it's in the poem, like you're punishing me, but yes, yeah, so I mean, also I just sensibilities, I mean, I think it's something like, you know, people are going to have to get used to. I had to get used to like writing that poem, you know.
What do you mean you had to get used to writing it?
I had to get used to the idea that I could write like this about this subject, because there are other ways, sort of like removed surface ways that I could write about, like I could have written that poem and sort of stood back as like, but I'm the good man who doesn't, like, you know, and you know people have those poems, it's like, bro, like you're not the good guy all the time. And I think that's, you know, that's another bit of advice I always give my students, is like, you can't always be the hero in your poems. And I've always understood that, but I think like this is the first book where I like really committed to like, okay, you keep telling that to people, but like for you to really do that, what does that look like? So I think that's this book.
Do you feel that it's your responsibility as a male person to write about issues of male privilege or patriarchy or power? In sort of analogous to the way a lot of people believe it's white people's responsibility to end racism and combat racism, not just the people who racism affects.
Yeah, I don't know if it's so much responsibility, but at some point you just realize things won't change if the conversation is always coming from one direction, right? You know, there's probably a way that brown people could end American racism. It would be bloody, but it could happen. It probably wouldn't happen because we're like, you know, not that large population. But bad idea strategically, which is what I always tell people when they start talking about rebellion stuff. I'm like, do you read the census? But yeah, I mean, I think the conversation doesn't evolve unless both sides are being open. So that's what it's more about. It's not so much about it's my responsibility to do this. It's like, if I care about this getting better, I have to, like, you know, send something back from the other side. It just can't be continue to receive, and see. It's like, well, what do you think? Why do you do these things? And that's, you know, the main thing. I think men get away with doing so much evil shit and never have to explain themselves. So I think that's part of what it is. It's like, you know, put your psyche on the paper so we can see who the hell we're dealing with. Because otherwise you just have to assume, and you know, there isn't much to work with.
Monica, how would you say that you put your psyche on the paper?
Very imperfectly.
And what are the big questions, and Kyle mentioned being wrong. What are the things that you feel that you're uncertain about that you're working out through your poetry or through your fiction? Makes sense, you're also a novelist.
Yeah, I mean, when you were talking about, when Kyle was talking about his students, I was thinking about something similar as well, which is, you know, having now taught like more than 10 years, I can see when a student has a really good poem in them and, like, you know, on the page, but it's being hampered by their desire to protect themselves, either by, you know, having like such a trellis of like beautiful vocabulary that that they're hiding and it's obscure, and you know, and everyone can say like, I really love your image and I love the sound, and but it's still not like breaking through. And so I actually think probably my students are sort of an inspiration for me to push further. I think in what I'm trying to do in my newer work, and also, yeah, moving forward from here, is to also remember the reader and remember the audience. And I think I used to forget about the reader, really. I would just be so caught up in trying to create, like, you know, like the well-wrought urn or something, like a pretty artifact. And I'd forget that it was actually a communication and an encounter with someone, you know, that you may meet. You know, you guys all had to hear my poem, so I get to see you and my encounters in person. Or it's somebody you never meet and you have no idea that they exist. And that's really special that it goes back and forth. And whatever you put down on the page is going to be fleshed out by somebody else's imagination. And like that's fully a part of the process of whatever that poem is once you published it. So remembering to like bring myself close enough that I can engage in that counter. I know that's kind of vague, but you know, I think it's about relinquishing. For me, it's a little bit about relinquishing control, so that I'm not dictating the reader's experience, but allowing them to participate in it. For example, to give you something specific, I like to use questions in poems because then it's not as though the speaker of the poems has all the facts, you know, which can feel very cold and remote as a you know, when you're reading something, and instead to engage them to wonder, and that's a part of the process.
Can I bounce off of to answer the question you asked earlier about what's changed between 2003 Kyle and like now? I realize that there's so much more I can do in terms of communicating people without the acrobatic language that I think I loved when I was 23. Mm-hmm. I mean, penetrating, because that's what it's, you know, I still play a lot of basketball, and, you know, it's interesting as an older person that, you know, you can start to lose your athleticism. You have to think of other ways to compete. And, you know, you'll watch like a young kid play basketball and he's just in front of you, like going ball behind the back, did it. And like, he's not going anywhere. He's just like right in front of you doing like everything. And you're just like, come on. And he comes to you and you block the ball. You're still, and it's like, that's what like poetry's like. That was me at 23. I was it. And like, you know, the world was like, okay, kid, you know, come on. So that's like a great, you know, revelation. You realize like how much more you can do with less in terms of purple language.
Yeah, I use an athletic metaphor too. I call it popping wheelies when somebody does that. They're, you know, it's the same thing. Like you're not going anywhere, but it's these like frivolous curly cues. No.
Yeah, I think so. That was always a challenge I tried to present to myself, is how can I write a poem without any metaphor or simile or any of the accoutrement of poetry and still make it poetic. How are we doing on time? Good, okay. Kyle, was there, would you say that there was a particular moment when you shifted into the kind of way material you're writing now? Was there a tipping point? Was there a particular something that made you, both in terms of some of the stuff having to do with patriarchy, but also the you mentioned the acrobatics. Was there a moment when you shifted over?
Yeah, there's actually more. I mean, there are a couple of poems that I'm attempting to engage and deconstruct masculinity and honest engine, but actually most of it is in this new manuscript. So like this is just sort of like, this book is actually the pivot, and the new manuscript is like the thing. But a lot of it, I think, just in terms of the way my brain started shifting with poetry, is like being in D.C., It's another type of shedding, because like right now, like the country is so wrapped in this election, and like in D.C., I'm like, well, I don't have any representation in Congress. I hang out like so weird thing. Like you probably think it's crazy. So one of my good friends in D.C., Armstrong Williams. Me and Armstrong hang out. He's a cool dude. You know, Armstrong Williams, the guy who's running Ben Carson's campaign. And, you know, that's the thing you realize about DC. It's like, okay, you guys fight like bastards in front of TV. And then the cameras go off and you go down to the Monaco and have drinks for like 8 hours. And it's like, well, you know, what? Because, you know, I remember I got to DC and like Bush was in office. And what is now Split This Rock started as DC Poets Against the War. And I remember, you know, they asked me to come. And I said, yeah, you know, I'll come. I'm down with that. And you get there. And, you know, great people, but like it was like a lot of just like bad, like Bush is bad poems. And you're like, I don't know if I really need a poem to understand that. Like it's pretty, I could watch C-SPAN for a good 15 minutes and get it. So sort of moving like, well, yeah, I want to write poems with impact, but I don't want to write poems that are surface in that way. Right. You know, I don't want to write poems that speak to the image of Washington. I want to write poems that are like more about D.C., which is like the people. It's like communication, like you were saying for me. Poetry is so much about communication. So just kind of figuring out how D.C. works and sort of learning how to shed yourself of the bullshit. I think that really affected my aesthetic because I had like a better sense of who I was talking to, what I was trying to speak to before just kind of like throwing poems at an issue. And the issue is like, I got a super PAC and I don't really care about your poem. So then you think, okay, well, then who am I gonna talk to? You talk to the people. And that shifted a lot for me.
Do you think those Bush's bad poems were a kind of cliche genre? Do you know what I mean? Like, it's very easy to be like, to go, I think, particularly to an open mic, you know, and be like, Bush sucks. Or I love my black queen, or, you know, like things in that genre of just like, okay, but say more about that.
There's this saying about this poet, I can't remember who it is, where the person says, of the arguments with myself, I make poems, and of the arguments with other people, I make rhetoric, you know, and so there's, you know, I have sort of adopted that, like, if I'm 100% certain about something, I probably shouldn't write a poem about it, but if I'm open to discovering something and to even noticing how I might be complicit in something, you know, then it's going to go below the surface that you were talking about.
I don't know if we're at that portion of the evening, but the gentleman here had a... Sorry. Sorry.
I just didn't want to. In your introduction to Honest Engine, you mentioned that you sort of taking the punches that, not physical punches, but punches that come with just life experience, and how that sort of affected your feeling of invincibility that many young people have. So I'm curious whether your sort of current interrogation of masculinity has to do with these sort of taking these blows of just life and getting older, and whether that has somehow informed your newer work and this sort of feeling of, you know, interrogating, you know, masculinity and, you know, manhood, et cetera.
That's part of it. I guess it's more so I want to show the sausage being made of masculinity. So say, for example, there's this poem in the new book where I talk about, so when I was a kid, once I found a Playboy under my cousin's couch, I'm like 11. We used to play Matt Live 96 all the time in his room. And I took it downstairs to my uncle, like the good narc I was. And I was like, look, he's got a Playboy. And my uncle was like, well, you know, at least we know he's not gay. And then little kid me was like, yeah, I guess that does make sense. And I go back upstairs playing video games. And now I'm thinking about it. I'm like, holy shit, that's where like homophobia like starts. Like he was teaching me how to be suspect of a man that does not have desire for what's in this weird magazine. Right. And so like that's one of the poems, and like there are other poems like that, and it's tricky because I don't want the book to come out and all the men who raised me, and they did raise me with love, but they're like nothing but villains in the book, because that's not fair either. So it's finding ways, like if I'm gonna go at them, then I have to go at myself too, because else it's not, you know, it's disingenuous, because I'm not a perfect man. So I think that's where the wounding is. Like I know where the pain is in my past, and I can dig that up and write poems about that fairly easily. But it's also me saying, well, if that was in me, then you perpetuated it in the world in some way at some point. So you have to like find the traces of it in your future as well if you're gonna write about where it came into your past. So I think that's where the wounding is for me, if that makes sense.
Does anyone else have questions? We can get into the Q&A portion of the evening.
This question is for Monica, but Kyle, if you have work that speaks to this question as well, you can spit. I was noticing that when you was talking about your love for history and mythology and fairy tales, and I was wondering, it's like whenever I'll write a poem or a line that has about a heart, and my mom would like give me 5 books about a heart to like research to investigate what this line should like mean. And so basically, I was wondering, in a poem, when do you come to the point where you take on, where you assume that your eyes aren't enough, where your personal experience on a particular subject is not enough, and you have to go for other sources to find out different vantage points for a particular poem? When do you think that like your eyes aren't enough?
I think your eyes are enough in a way. Thank you. I kind of think your eyes are enough, first of all, because we should be able to trust our own sensibilities as well. But, you know, I think all of that other stuff can enrich your work. And so kind of when I'm stuck is when I turn to that, you know, stuff, and I think, well, what if I looked up, like, you know, what this insect really, you know, what's actually like the scientific jargon around this insect? And then it'll allow me to be more specific instead of vague, you know, and to say something that maybe you don't see in every poem, because, you know, you're following the trail of your curiosity to that thing, and you're doing that discovering and you're bringing it, you know, out into the light for other people to experience. So, I don't know. I mean, I wouldn't find there to be a problem with not doing that if you didn't feel moved to it. But if you, like, I don't know if you know the poet, speaking of heart, Lillian Yvonne Bertram, she's got, you know, she came to my school recently, and she was talking about, she spent like a year or a semester on this college campus, and like the science lab allowed her to take a heart out of the lab, and she like carried it around and kept it in her fridge, just so she could actually see this thing that you know, that we're always talking about metaphorically, but she wanted to like feel the weight of it and like see its actual color, and you know, I'm sure that's gonna turn into some amazing poems, because she's had an experience that's so singular. Well, I guess except for people in the morgue and, you know, heart surgeons, but you know, it can only enrich. But I don't think it's necessary, I would argue, with your mom, you know. Yeah, especially in terms of the terminology, because, you know. I sometimes give people the assignment of like going out and finding a text that's like from before the year 1900, and then, you know, using the vocabulary that's in that text to write a poem on any topic, because then it sort of pushes you out of your comfort zone with those words that, you know, you use all the time in your poems. Yeah. Did you want
to? No. That was a good answer.
I have a question about the openness that we spoke about earlier. You know, I would tell my students that in order to be more open on the page and to kind of remove the shroud, you should think of the I character, not as yourself as a writer, but someone you know very well. And since we've been talking about it, I've been turning that over and over in my head thinking, is that simply putting the shroud back on? Making yourself as a character on the page as opposed to in separating yourself from the writer who's creating the work. So I wonder if both of you could speak to becoming a character and how that kind of maybe separates you as the writer from the work.
So like the lyric eye. I guess for me, the lyric eye, ultimately, I look at it as like training wheels, right? You know, like, so maybe you're not at the point where you can like fully exist on the page and say, this is me, as flawed, as confusing as it might be. So you say, well, you know, I have this constructed persona. Some of it's me, some of it's things I brought in and crafted. And I don't think that's the end point. You know, at some point, I think you maybe want to at least try to push past that eye to saying, okay, like, maybe I can really say these contradictory things, you know, Whitman, you know, I contain multitudes. I'm a great poet and I'm a racist. I don't know if we necessarily got those poems out of Whitman. It would have been, but that's why, I mean, that's why I like Tony Coghlan so much, because he's just willing to be so damn messy on the page. Like, I'm reading his new book now, and there are poems where I'm like, oh man, I'm like, poems like, you're an asshole. But it's honest. Like, it's honest, because like that's who we are. Like, no one's perfect all the time. Like, you know, love Maya Angelou, right? But like, and if, of course, like, not including the memoir, you get a different picture. But if you're just thinking about poems, right? You know, like, you're not always going to present or be in the mood to present, certain personas. So I just think you have to be willing to be messy, but I think it depends on your intent. Like, if you do it in a way that shows, again, like, you're not out to exploit or hurt or make fun of others by divulging how you're imperfect, like, it's okay. And I think the lyric eye is a way to get there. But I don't think it's the full transformation. I think there's still work to go. There's work to do after that. Personally.
Yeah. There's this quote by this painter where he says, like, painting is like all these little lies that tell a big truth together. And so I think that, like, And relatedly, like, I found in writing about certain subjects, like, you know, let's say you're writing about a particular relationship, like, you know, a poem is like a partial view of that. Like, it can't be, we're all these, you know, like, we're constantly changing our minds and we feel so different from day to day and from like hour to hour. If you think like, I'm gonna get the truth down on the page, it can sometimes like prevent you from telling the truth, kind of, because because I think we can only give voice to like versions of ourselves. So that's why I think it's kind of, you know, would be my argument like for using, you know, a self who you can separate from, you know, a speaker of a poem who isn't exactly you, because sometimes it can help you like get at the truth of that situation more than if you had to, sometimes I see, you know, a student struggling over writing a poem, like an elegy to, someone they cared about. And they try to put the totality of that whole relationship into that poem. And I think it's too much. You know, the poem like sinks under the weight of that burden. But you can get at a little part of it. You know, and saying the speaker isn't you and the poem isn't the whole truth kind of gives you a freedom and liberates you to be able to, get at things in smaller ways, slanted ways.
Actually, a question for Monica and Kyle, but Kyle, you mentioned Tony Hoagland a couple times, and I just have to ask you, what is your take on that now infamous poem, The Change, which is honest, and you appreciate the honesty in Tony Hoagland's poetry. So what, how do you feel about this? And to your point, Monica, about giving voice to partial selves, or maybe sides of ourselves that we don't always admire or own. What is your take on that poem?
You know, it's interesting. I taught a workshop on engaging, I guess, the other, and I used that poem along with some other things. I used Franny Choi's poem, The Poor Fried Rice. I used the Lucille Clifton poem, The Times. And the thing is, it seems like for like baby boomer generation and up, like they love that poem. Like in terms of thinking about how it gets them to open up about their subconscious bias. Try to use that poem with millennials and younger, like they hate that poem because they feel like it's so obvious. And they also, I think a lot of millennials too don't believe they have subconscious bias. They're like, oh, we figured it, we're different, we're past racism. I'm like, oh, okay, like how many friends do you have that aren't from the same class and ethnicity as you? Oh, well, yeah. So I always have to factor that into my answer about the change. Like I think he wrote that for, there is an audience for that poem. And for me, I think that audience, right, and ideal audience is Caucasian people 45 and up. And for others, like there's gonna be a different poem. You know, do I think it's, you know, racist? I mean, no, I mean, going back to the idea of like showing the sausage being made, the change is a poem where you can like see the sausage being made. It's not just saying, you know, I hold these beliefs. It's like, I hold these beliefs and this is why. Like you can see it, you can point back to something and say, okay, this is how the persona in this poem, be it Tony Hoagland or not, got to be this person. That's interesting to me. Like, I don't think I necessarily, I can probably assume, you know, that people are complicated, you know, in ways that are unpleasant. Like, that's fine. That's all true. I want to see this. I want to understand you. And that's why I feel like I can get with Tony Hoagland's poems. I'm like, yeah, I may not agree with the position, but I can see how you got there. Like, I can see the work, like, show the work in the math. I can see the work. That's interesting to me because I don't think you often get that. But I do also say I think it's more than appropriate for, you know, African-American women to be offended by the poem. Just like I don't necessarily feel good all the time reading the dream songs. I'm like, it's great. I'm like, okay. I feel ways about it sometimes, but, you know, I hear you. So I think both responses to the work are valid.
And could you just say briefly what that poem is about by Tony Hoagland, The Change?
So I guess it's sort of a satirized or abstracted account of watching Serena Williams beat, I don't know, that's the thing, I don't know exactly who the opponent would have been at that time, maybe Sharapova, I don't know, but like some.
Oh, it's the Dutch. Oh, okay.
Yeah, I don't know. And just, you know, Tolkien talking about how, you know, watching this match between, you know, an African-American tennis player who is, you know, you can tell, like, you know, muscular, tall, against like the smaller sort of like, you know, European woman, and how he sort of chooses sides in this, you know, subconsciously for no other reason than, you know, someone, I think he has to say, of my tribe. And you can interrogate that, you know, as you choose. So I don't know, that's sort of, I usually have that book on me. I have this new book on me, but I don't have What Narcissism Means to Me on me. Sorry. Failed.
You had a follow-up question? No, I'm also curious about Monica's perspective on this as well.
Oh man, that poem. I don't know. At the time, I remember saying, because I was there at the, you know, the at ABP when Claudia gave her, you know, she used the time when she was supposed to be reading to do, you know, this whole thing, right? She gave the whole address, and then she read Tony Hoagland's response, or rather, she had Nick Flynn read Tony Hoagland's response. And at the time, I thought, like, he could have so easily covered his tracks by just saying, it's a persona poem. I don't really think this, you know. But he actually, like, you know, said, no, this is me. And he doubled down on it, and he really insisted. So I'm really troubled by the poem. And I'm also really troubled by some people's response to it, you know? Namely, like, I heard these people, you know, after the reading, who were talking about how great Tony Hoagland was for, not being PC and, like, saying it like it is. And, I get the feeling, I mean, a little bit like, not to be really political, but, like, you know, like Trump now, with, you know, and so I'm worried not just about what's in there, because I agree with you, like, you know, people can't just make themselves out to be the heroes of all their poems. We don't learn anything. It seems disingenuous. Like, we really need to understand other people. And the only way communication can happen is by, like, you know, is by this honesty. So I definitely see the argument for that. But I think it can have a, you know, it certainly seemed to have a pernicious effect on some people who were championing that poem, I think, for the wrong reasons. So but I don't know.
It hasn't hurt his career at all. I mean,
what'd you say?
It hasn't hurt his career at all, yeah. This poem.
But then who am I to say what people should write about or not write about? He's obviously doing pretty well for himself, so... And he's a craftsman.
I'd say he ruined himself in the sense that there are some people where if I say, hey, you should maybe read this Tony Hoagland poem, it's like me saying, hey, you should read this self-help book by David Duke. And like, it's not the same, but then some people, so I think that's what that poem has done. It's like, it's just made him, there's some people that are just like, no, I'm not reading Tony Hoagland at all. And I think that's, you know, I think that's a mistake. But Hoagland, Hoagland. Oh, someone needs a mic back.
So you both mentioned communicating with the reader, and then I think it was Kyle that mentioned an ideal audience. And I was wondering if you have an ideal audience in mind, because there's always a question, I guess particularly in immigrant fiction, of who are you writing to? And so I wondered if you have an ideal audience and how much that, if you do, how much that factors in when it comes to putting together your poetry, references, fiction, whatever, and if you feel you're reaching them.
Me?
Yeah.
I don't know. Do you have an ideal reader?
No.
I don't think I do.
I'm more interested in Harriet Mullen's idea of the unimagined reader. It's like the readers you don't even know will be reading your work. Like, so you think about, right? She could have hoped, but there's really no way for Phyllis Wheatley to have imagined that Claudia Rankine would exist today, right? Mm-hmm. But you have to write as though that's possible. So I think that that's what it is. You write for the audience that you don't even know may need your work in the future, which I think is really important when you're like writing that thing and you feel like, oh, you know, it's just not catching on. It's like maybe the people you're writing for aren't here yet.
Yeah.
And that's hard. It's a hard thing to hold on and keep writing, because they may get here after you're gone. But, you know, you still owe it to that exchange to put yourself into the work.
I like that answer. I'm gonna take that answer. It's never the, like, I just got this note the other day from this guy who read the collection and he really liked it, and I looked him up, and like, he's not who I imagined, you know what I mean? That would be my ideal reader. He's in this like rural community, he's like 70 years old, he's, you know, seriously, and he's white, and he's definitely not me, you know what I mean? I'm the opposite of all those things. I'm a woman, I'm urban dweller, you know, so I don't know that I could predict that it would have touched him, and it makes me really psyched that it did, because you know, and that's like the other half of the encounter is like, I don't know what's in, you know, I mean, it's the reader isn't just like a, you know, for me now, the reader isn't just like a recipient of what I'm writing, but is also like bringing something. And yeah, and you never know what they could possibly be bringing in, you know, and we all have our own like private way of using language. We all have associations that, you know, when I say like popsicle, like you're picturing maybe, you know, when you first had your popsicle and, you know, or maybe you never got to have popsicles. And so you're picturing your bitterness and like, I can never predict how my words are gonna bounce off of like your associations. So I think I would psych myself out too much if I thought about it because I get like stage fright then, I think.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you all for coming. Another round of applause for our poets, Monica, Kyle, and our fabulous moderator, Kyla. Please stay, buy books, chat with the poets. Our great volunteer, Charlene, is over there if you want to buy books. Ask the poets to sign it. Stick around. Talk to us. Thank you.
Refreshments.